This is a guide on how to use the Dark Project software. So, let's get on with it. At startup, we're greeted by three tabs: the Home tab, the Device tab, and the Macro tab. The Home tab is where your various Dark Project devices will appear. In this scenario, I only have one keyboard. Clicking on your device takes you straight to the device customization section of this program. This is the devices section. Here, you can handle most of the operations and customization of your keyboard. As you can see, here you can choose which key combinations you would like to be disabled, for example, Winlock. On the top left corner of your program, you can see the profile you're currently using. This software allows you to set up different profiles for different use cases. You can create a profile like so. On the top right corner of your screen, you can see two different features: App Mode and Onboard Editor. After choosing App Mode, any change you apply to your keyboard will only be active when the Dark Project software is running. If the software is not open in the background, then the changes you have applied won't work either. The Onboard Editor feature records everything you assign to the internal memory of the keyboard. These changes will be available at any given time, with or without the software, on your computer or any other computer from this point onwards. We can now move on to the basic operations of the keyboard. Let's start with the RGB backlight settings. Clicking on the light bulb icon takes you to the RGB settings. Here, you will find several modes to choose from. You can change the color and the brightness settings, as well as the speed of the animation that will play. Once you have found your ideal backlight animation, you can simply press OK in order to apply the changes to your keyboard. Now we can move on to the Start tab. There are two main modes of operation. The first mode of operation is through App Mode. This is where you can remap keys, disable some others, use them as multimedia combinations, or you could even set up your macro trigger keys. The second mode of operation can only be accessed through the Onboard Editor. Please note that while you're in Onboard Editor mode, the keyboard will not work because you're in direct access with the keyboard's built-in memory. Once you save your configuration or once you close out of Onboard Editor, the keyboard will work normally again. That being said, we can move on to the Onboard Editor. I always suggest making a backup of your current configuration before making changes in this section, as all the changes you're gonna make are permanent and will still be active with or without the software. Having a backup of your configuration allows you to revert any changes that you have made without having to go through the process of undoing them one by one. Entering the Onboard Editor also unlocks two additional layers, the default layer and the FN1 layer. The default layer is how your keyboard operates without having to press down any additional buttons, such as the FN button. You can also reassign everything here to any button and actually change its actions. For this example, I'm going to use the F12 button. We can then move on to remap key and press any button. For this example, I will use the Q button. Now every time you press F12, it will be as if you press the Q button itself. Let's undo this change we just made. We can do this by clicking on the soft keyboard below to get back the F12 button. The success message box means that everything has been recorded successfully. Here you can also assign certain key combinations to use as multimedia buttons, to raise or lower volume, or to even play or pause music, for example. This covers most of the functionalities of the default layer. The FN1 layer is a layer you can fully customize according to your specific needs. The purpose of the FN1 layer is to give you more functionality tailored to your needs without losing the original functionality of the keyboard. For the FN1 layer to work, you first need to assign the FN1 button. The FN1 button can be any button of your choice except the FN key. Whenever you hold down the assigned FN1 button, the FN1 layer will be activated. For this demonstration, I will use the right control key, and then click Set FN1. Now, whenever you hold down this button, the FN layer will activate, and as such, you can use whatever button you want for whatever reason. For this example, I will assign the volume up function to the up arrow button, and the volume down function to the down arrow button. Once you feel that you're happy with your FN1 layer, click Download to save the configuration. The keyboard will flicker a few times, and then you should get the message Download configuration successful. These settings have been loaded into the keyboard, and now when I press the right control key and my assigned multimedia, everything will work as I planned. This concludes everything for the Devices tab. We have now covered most of the software's capability and we'll be moving on to the third tab, the Macro tab. Here, we can manage our macros. We can import macros using this button and we can create new ones using the plus button. Furthermore, we can export, rename, or delete our macros by clicking on the three dots next to them. In the section below your macro groups, you will find the delay settings. That means how much delay should be in between your key presses or clicks. Recording delay means it will keep the original delay that is captured when you record the macro. Default delay means you can set your delay to a certain number that will always remain the same. And last but not least, no delay means there will be no delay between your key presses or clicks. On the right side of your screen, you can manually add macro events without the need to record them. You can choose to insert an event before or after another. Below, under event, you can choose which key you want to register. You can choose either mouse buttons or keyboard keys. For this example, we're gonna choose keyboard and select the X key by just pressing it and clicking insert. The modded section is for editing pre-existing events. Click on the event you want to edit. Now, you can change the delay as well as any keyboard or mouse event you wish to replace the pre-existing event with. To replace it, simply click modify. This covers everything I know about this software. If you have found this video informative, please drop a like or a comment. If you believe I have overlooked something, or if you have any additional questions, please comment below and I will get back to you as soon as possible. Good luck, have fun, and happy gaming!